the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Good morning, and a very warm welcome to you all to this service of morning prayer on Christ the King Sunday, which is the last Sunday of the Pentecost season. Today, we are delighted to welcome Dr. Harry Schmitz as our preacher this morning, one of our own parishioners, and a leader of our meditation room, the Trinity Southport Meditation Room. Welcome, Harry. We begin with the opening sentences. Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Hallelujah.
A reading from Ephesians. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints. And for this reason, I do not cease to give thanks for you as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your heart enlightened, you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the working of his great power. God put this power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet, and has made him the head over all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The appointed psalm for this week is Psalm 95. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before
his presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to him with psalms.
For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods.
In his hand are the caverns of the earth, and the heights of the hills are his also.
The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have molded the dry land.
Come, let us bow down and bend the knee, and kneel before the Lord, our Maker.
For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from the Gospel of Matthew. Jesus said, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people from one another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, 'Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you?' And the king will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of those who are members of my family, you did it to me.' Then he will say to those at his left hand, 'You that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me.' Then they also will answer, 'Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you?' Then he will answer them, 'Truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me.' And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Welcome to this feast day of Christ the King, a day we celebrate the kingdom of God, the reign of God. In the first reading of Ephesians, we are told that we need not worry or fear, for we are the children of God, members of the body of Christ. In this reading, we can see that Christ is proclaimed to be above all authority, all power. He is proclaimed as the head, the ruler of the kingdom. While Scripture employs the phrase kingdom of God or kingdom of heaven, the scriptural phrase reign of God is a better descriptor. When we say kingdom of God or of heaven, it's very easy to think of a place that isn't what Jesus meant. For example, he tells Pontius Pilate rather directly, my kingdom is not of this world. And in another scriptural passage, he states, the kingdom of God is within you. It's clearly not a place. It's not what Jesus meant. That means that God's reign is not a nation, a government, a political entity, an organization. It's not a theocracy, or even a church or a religion. Matthew's great parable of the Last Judgment offers revealing commentary on the reign of God. In preparing for this sermon quite candidly, I struggled to try and soften this hard message of judgment and punishment, especially since we live in such hard and demanding times. Well, that's not necessary, for there is encouraging news, surprising news. So hang on. Matthew presents the glorified Son of Man accompanied by a retinue of angels, rising before the gathered nations of the world. The blessed and the eternal punished are separated by the Son of Man according to one norm, one single standard, the care of others, especially those in need. The reward or punishment of the choices we make is said to last forever. In other words, we're stuck with the consequences of our actions as a nation and as individuals. Well, that's true. You know that. I know that. We do our best to teach that notion to children. I believe Matthew Jesus is saying more, much, much more. In Matthew's parable, Jesus addresses the evil of human oppression and the best tradition of the Jewish prophet. According to New Testament biblical scholar and Jesuit priest Dennis Ham, the divine judgment parable offers one of the most famous recognition themes in all of world literature. The assembly of all the nations get three surprises in this recognition theme. First, the king and judge of all turns out to be not some wielder of military or media might, but Jesus of Nazareth, the son of a carpenter. The second surprise is that the sole criterion of judgment is how they, the nation, and each and every person, you and me, have treated needy persons, those who are hungry, thirsty, estranged, naked, ill, or imprisoned. The final shocking surprise is that the king has taken such treatment, be it aid or neglect, quite personally to heart. Furthermore, the king absolutely identifies with that suffering. Those who suffer and the king are one and the same. Like all of Scripture, the parable of the end times is a judgment on the world and a judgment on the human behavior of persons who follow the way of the world. That's where you and I come in, dear friends. As I mentioned earlier, there is a bigger story, a story bigger than a parable of consequences. It's a parable of choices, choices to be made, either choose life in the world or life in the reign of God. It's that straightforward. So what's the difference between the two? The world is built on the dynamics of power and domination. In this model, there is division, winners, losers, us, them. In the way of the world, we use language like battleground, others, fight. It's about ego, self-centeredness, success at any cost. It really is enough to make your head spin and not be drawn into that battle. Choosing the way of the reign of God presents us with a distinctively different path, a life-changing path. When Jesus began his public life, he said, "The reign of God is at hand. Change your lives. Change your lives." The reign of God is a verb. It's an action, an opportunity to renew the world. And that action indeed means change. It's no wonder why the early Christians call themselves people of the way. It's an idea of living out the reign of God here and now, and later too, in making our relationships right and compassionate. It's God's dream for the world. His self-revelation is found at the lowest end of any measure of prestige and power. It's agape, as the Greeks called it. We don't have an equivalent English word to express in one word what agape means. It's unconditional love, self-sacrificing love, the love shown by Jesus Christ, Rosa Parks, Martin Luther King, Gandhi, and the faith-doubting but believing Mother Teresa of Calcutta, all putting themselves on the line for the needy and the outcasts. With the exception of Jesus Christ, none of these people were perfect. Let's put aside the notion of whether or not they or we are goats or sheep. It's solidarity and accompaniment of each other that enlarges everyone's humanity. In all candor, I think that at any one point in time, any one of us might be a sheep or a goat or both. The story is not about applying labels to ourselves or others. It's about picking up our cross, no more than that. It's picking up our cross and the crosses of persons in need. It's there where the reign of God fully exists. Following Jesus, the Son of Man, means you and I have a calling, and we have responsibilities to take on, to put action into compassionate service of the other. It doesn't matter who our leaders are, ultimately. It really doesn't. Our responsibilities remain the same, to be in solidarity with those in need, and to be inclusively welcoming. According to Protestant theologian Walter Wink, the world and its powers and dominations are falling, yet they can be redeemed. And that's our job, we who follow Christ and all persons of goodwill must not stand idly by and watch this world fall more. We can look at the ways of the world and step in to bring compassion, accompaniment, and life-giving change. According to our Bishop Ian Douglas, Jesus lived in a very political world. Of course, he didn't take a partisan position, but he didn't stand aside or walk away. Jesus spoke up, he encountered and healed, he attended the lame and the grieving, and most of all, he gave his love and life for all, for you and for me. He took on the powers, the dominations, the uncaring leaders of his time. Truth be told, the journey of the way of Christ the King is not to get me or you to heaven. That's not the message. The journey itself is what's really important, as long as it serves and accompanies those in need. This is what builds the reign of God, that entry into and participation in the thin spaces of our lives, that interlude, that present, but not quite yet present, timeless moment of grace and love, where the distance between heaven and earth is almost non-existent. It's the breath space sometimes. We all know these fleeting moments of grace and gladness that occur when we read to a child, or visit a homebound person, or lose ourselves in a sunset, or participate in one of many of Trinity's programs, like outreach, or joining courageous conversations to address systemic racism, or weekly online meditation in the Trinity Southport Meditation Room. All of these are kingdom opportunities where encounter, and consolation can be found, dear friends. In coming to a close, I'd like to say that there's much work to be accomplished to help spread the reign of God. The building of the kingdom requires much of us, more than any of us can accomplish in a lifetime. So much so that I'm reminded of the story poet Maya Angelou told. She described an encounter with a man who told her he disagreed with some stances he had taken. He then told her he knew better because he was a Christian. With typical Angelou attitude, she placed both hands on her hips, cocked her head to the side, and said, "Honey, I thought becoming a Christian took a lifetime." Building the kingdom will indeed take a lifetime. The task welcome each of us to discern our call to spread God's reign. I'd like to close my comments by asking you at home to sit comfortably in a comfortable chair. Take a few deep breaths, be still, and listen to the words of the next thing you're about to hear. Let all mortal flesh keep silent. It's one of my favorite hymns. I hope it's one of yours. You may wish to reflect on the lyrics later. It's in your program. The hymn is a wonderful reflection about our God, King of all rulers, who came to us in human vesture to be one with us in love and service. And so I'd like to close with a prayer. We are grateful to you, dear Lord, for loving each and every one of us, for giving of yourself as food for all who are poor and oppressed. Help us to be silent and know that you are our loving God. Amen. Thank you.
the Lord be with you. Let us pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Almighty and everlasting God, whose will it is to restore all things in your well-beloved Son, the King of kings and Lord of lords, mercifully grant that the peoples of the earth, divided and enslaved by sin, may be freed and brought together under his most gracious rule, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The prayers of the people. Let us pray for the church and for the world. Great Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and lead all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. We pray especially for Alexa Wheeler, Judy Nestle, Bert, Kathy, Don Callahan, Harrison, Brad Olson, Steve J., Karar Mansfield, Joanne Garten, Whitney, Chris, Isabel Cortez, John Rogers, Rachel, Nancy Long, Patria and Peter Swan, Lindsay Hunt, Margie Fowler, Robert, Adam DeVanier, Lisa Favorini, Drew Lipner, Kathy, John, Claudia, Sean Sullivan, Janet, Tom, and all others whom we now name, either silently or aloud. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, especially those who suffered from the coronavirus, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all of your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Lord, hear the prayers of your people, and what we have asked faithfully, may you grant effectually through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. We offer this prayer for our country. Almighty God, to whom we must account for all our powers and privileges, guide the people of the United States and this community in the election of officials and representatives, that by faithful administration and wise laws, the rights of all may be protected and our nation be enabled to fulfill your purposes through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. On this Thanksgiving weekend, as we approach Thanksgiving, the weekend before Thanksgiving, we give thanks for the good work that is begun in this community and around the nations. Strengthen our efforts, Lord, to blot out ignorance and prejudice and to abolish poverty and crime. And hasten the day when all our people, with many voices in one united chorus, will glorify your holy name. Amen. Now let us say together the general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all, for your immeasurable love and the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. Let us humbly confess our sins against God and our neighbor, saying together, Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. My sisters and brothers, the peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us share the peace with one another. Peace be with you. And peace to everyone at home. Peace in the balcony. Please be seated. Good morning, everyone, and a warm welcome to our recorded service today, which was coming to you at 8 o'clock and 10 o'clock on Sunday, on Christ the King Sunday. Christ the King Sunday is the last Sunday of Pentecost before we enter into the season of Advent. So I want to say how grateful we are this morning to hear the words of our dear friend, Dr. Harry Schmitz, who offered us a sermon today for the first time at Trinity. Harry Schmitz is one of our parishioners here, and I just want to share with you a little bit about what he does at Trinity, which is wonderful. He leads a virtual meditation class, sessions, and we call it the Trinity Meditation Room. He's certified as a lay preacher for the Southwest region of the Episcopal Diocese of Connecticut. He's a member of our choir and our adult education team, our book club, and Courageous Conversations. He's also one of Trinity's two representatives to Diocesan Convention. His craft in his career has been as a clinical psychologist, and he is a former university professor. He headed his own international consulting firm providing psychologically based services to Fortune 500 companies and other organizations. And he and his wife, Maria, are both residents of Easton, and they have three grown children and several grandchildren. So we welcome to our pulpit this morning, Dr. Harry Schmitz, and we thank you, Harry, for your wonderful interpretation of the scripture for all of us. Thank you so much. Let us turn to our our announcements. We have a special cellist today, Sam Powell, who's just 17 years old, a senior at Staples High School, who has been accepted into the prestigious program at Manhattan School of Music and the Aspen Music Festival, the New York Youth Symphony, and we're very delighted to have him among us today. I want to thank our soloist, Claire Bowman, who's been singing at Trinity for as long as she can remember. She's a very faithful member of our choir, and she was a competitive swimmer in high school, and now she works as an emergency veterinary technician at Newtown Veterinary Specialist, which is where she has a lot of passion for animals and all kinds of creatures. I'd like to share with you that this is our stewardship season at Trinity, and so please join us in giving thanks for all the gifts that we have received by offering a weekly pledge to Trinity Church. If you did not receive a pledge packet, please let us know. Our goal this year is 100% participation of all the parish. So please do send in your pledge so that we can plan our budget for the coming year.
For those of you I haven't met, my name is Luke Davis, and I'm speaking to you today on behalf of Trinity Stewardship Committee, including Reverend Peggy, John Kreitler, Michael Banton, Virginia Cargill, Victor Hewitt, and Nelson North. Today, we're entering the final week of our annual appeal, this year called Our House is Built on the Rock. We as a committee are incredibly pleased with the appeal to date, as we're more than 80% of the way to our financial goals. I'd like to express our deep gratitude to those of you who have pledged so far, more than 70 households, including 8 households who have pledged for the first time, and 28 households have increased their pledges by 11% on average. We plan to acknowledge everyone who's pledged in the bulletin on Sunday, December 6th. Your collective generosity is a strong endorsement of the parish's strategic plan that we've developed over the last 2 years to allow Trinity to deepen its spiritual growth, education, and music programming for members of all ages. I'd like to also acknowledge Lisa Todd, Harry Schmitz, the Dutter family, and Wendy Ryan, each of whom have recorded a video about what Trinity means to them for this year's appeal. If you haven't seen these moving testimonials, I encourage you to check them out at Trinity's website under the Stewardship tab. As we close out the 2021 appeal, I invite all of those who have not yet pledged to reflect on the place that Trinity holds in your lives and to pledge generously so that we can meet our goals of 100% participation. You can find a pledge card on our website, or you can email trinity@finance@trinitysouthport.org. God bless you and best wishes for a safe and joyous Thanksgiving.
Right now we are in a strange time in our community with Fairfield being in a red alert for the coronavirus, and we've had to revert back to these online services. I just want to thank you all for your presence this morning, for supporting us. We'd all, of course, prefer to be in person and to see one another, but we also want to keep everyone safe. So please bear with us for these next 2 Sundays. This week and next week will be online only, and then we're going to reevaluate where we are. So please stay tuned. Right after this 10 o'clock service, we will have a special virtual Zoom coffee hour. So I hope that you can join us. You can look on Facebook for the announcement of the Zoom link, or you can look at This Week at Trinity and click on the link there, or you can find it in the bulletin. We have Advent wreath packages for next Sunday, so please call if you would like to sign up, click on the link, or you can call the office if you'd like a special Advent wreath package. And we have a new announcement this week, 5 ways that you can help to feed the hungry during the holidays. You can cook Thanksgiving dinner for Operation Hope, make sandwiches for St. John's, help provide Thanksgiving meal ingredients for Children and Family Services of Bridgeport, donate to St. John's Food Pantry, or support our outreach initiatives to address food insecurity. So please do help at this holiday time. Thank you so much for your attention to these announcements. And now we will continue with our offertory sentence and a special solo by Claire. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings and come into his courts with praise. Receive the blessing. Life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who make the journey with us. So be swift to love, make haste to be kind. And the blessing of God Almighty, our Creator, our Redeemer, and our Sanctifier, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. May the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace in believing through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.